And it will be the sign of the covenant between me and you. For the generations to come, every male among you who is 8 days old must be circumcised, including those born in your household or bought with money from a foreigner, those who are not your offspring, whether born in your household or bought with your money, they must be circumcised. My covenant in your flesh is to be an everlasting covenant. Any uncircumcised male who has not been circumcised in the flesh will be cut off from his people. He's broken my covenant. God also said to Abraham, as for Sarai, your wife, you're no longer to call her Sarai. Her name will be Sarah. Okay, so what is Abraham's commitments or responsibilities? Yeah. Okay, so you ladies go, okay. You know, no. No, it's a big deal. It's a big deal for us men.
Yes, it is.
And here's the thing. You know, of course, 8 days old, when you're circumcised, you don't even have a terrible, horrible memory of it. You just have a, you know. But it would be, I want to put this gently, but the Bible always puts things plainly, too, right? So we're mature, okay, for the most part. All right, so here's the thing. There's no male Hebrew that would ever not remember on a daily basis he was in covenant with God. You get me?
Yes.
So this is my covenant in your flesh. And circumcision is the sign of the covenant. Now, there are signs of other covenants that you mentioned. What are some of the other covenant's signs?
Rainbow.
Rainbow. Very good. What are some other covenant signs?
What was the tearing of the curtain.
What's that?
The tearing of the curtain.
Ooh, yeah, the tearing of the curtain, okay. The sign of, well, actually, the sign of the covenant with Israel would also be circumcision. What about David and Jonathan? Was there a sign of their covenant? You know, the best thing I can think of is probably when Jonathan shot the arrows to indicate.
Well, when he defied his father for David.
For,
that was a big deal.
That was huge. I mean, that was life and death. Ah, Mephibosheth. Oh, now that's a cool story, and that's covenant. I told you 6 degrees of Kevin Bacon, right? So here's the thing. David, Jonathan, and his two brothers, and Saul all die in a battle against the Philistines on the same day. That's the end of the entire line, right? And it's just one verse. Jonathan and his two brothers were killed in the battle. But then you get the rest of the chapters about Saul's death, right? He falls on his sword. His servant won't do it. He's injured because the archers got their range on him, all that kind of thing, right? And then they find his body, cut it up, and they do terrible things, right? And then they go to David, tell David. David weeps. We know all about that. Years pass. At that time, though, at the day of the battle, when they find out that Saul has died, we also find out that Mephibosheth, Jonathan's son, is 5 years old. Nurse picks him up. They're all on the run because everybody knows what happens when there is a regime change back in that day, right? Heads roll, literally. So they're thinking, we got to protect this kid. Pick him up. She drops him. Now he's lame, right? So years later, David is saying to his court, is there anybody left in the house of Saul of which I can do good for the sake of my covenant friend, Jonathan? And they're all looking around and say, well, Ziba was Saul's servant. So they bring Ziba in, and Ziba says, yeah, there's a kid, Jonathan's son, still alive. And he's out in a place, and this is really interesting, where the name of the town is No Grass. That was the name of the town where he was living. He was living in a wasteland. I mean, it's the king that should have been, right? Here's a prince lined up for glory, and all of a sudden, now he's living in a wasteland. All right? And so David says, fetch him. He comes in, and y'all remember the story. He comes in hobbling and, you know, kind of stuff. And David calls his name, and he says, what do you want with a dead dog like me? You know, I'm nobody. I'm nothing. You don't need to kill me. You don't need to do anything. I live in a wasteland. I'm a nobody. And David just ignores that. And he says, you come and do what? Eat at my table all the rest of your days. And Ziba's and his 15 sons, because Ziba's a rich guy, is going to now be your servant. And all of Saul's holdings are now yours. I mean, so here's Mephibosheth lifted, right, to this incredible height where he was a nobody living in a no-grass wasteland. And thinking, I'm a dead dog. And why does Jonathan do it? Does he doesn't know Mephibosheth? Right? He does it because of his covenant with David.
I mean, Jonathan.
His father. And guys, we are Mephibosheth. If I can do this and preach for a minute, you and I are Mephibosheth. We are dead dogs living in a no wasteland. We're not Jews. We're not part of the tribe. We're not part of the people that had the, as Paul said in Romans, theirs is the patriarchs. Theirs are the promises. Theirs is the law. Theirs are the wonders and signs. Theirs is all of this. Oh, how I'd just give up my own standing if my people would come to Christ, right? So you and I don't have any of that. God takes something that's nothing, right, and turns it into something. God takes the people who are not and turns them into a people. We are engrafted branches. All of those illustrations, we are Mephibosheth. We are nothing. And yet because of covenant, we are brought in, and you are now heirs, you're children of the Father. You're not servants, for a servant has nothing, Jesus says in John 13. He says, but I call you my... All of a sudden, we're all of this. And it's not because of anything we did or who we are or the genealogy or the pedigree. It's just because of covenant. Isn't that cool? And God has been trying to reestablish that relationship that was in the garden all along. And he's a God of covenants. And Jesus is a Lord of covenants. Because God's image doesn't change then, now, and in the future. So here we have this beautiful moment where Mephibosheth comes in and is exalted, and it's the same with you and me. We are exalted to a state that we didn't deserve, couldn't have had, except because of covenant. All right, man, I've gone to preaching and we're way off, and we got 8 minutes. All right, So Randy Frazee, remember this book called The Story?
Yes.
I mentioned this before. He talks about, he really captures a concept, the upper story and the lower story in the Bible. You see God's upper story, his will and his activities and what his design is surfacing throughout. And then you, the lower story is you and me and people like Abraham and Paul and others that are caught up in that upper story from time to time and find out, hey, I was a part of this, or don't even know that they were part of the engine, if you will, that moves the upper story. So when Frazee does this, you look at Abraham's life for a moment. You've got him in this upper story in Genesis 15 and 17. God comes along. He commits in covenant. I will, I will, I will, you will, you will, you will. And then Abraham just kind of goes and does his thing. What happens in chapter 12? When God first calls him out of the land of the Chaldees, if you look at verses 10 through 20, what does Abram do after God calls him out? After he travels and after he stops at the great trees of Mamre. But not in verses 10 through 20. Look at 10 through 20. What's he do? There's famine in the land. And what's he do?
He
goes to Egypt. And he says, you know, Carlene, you know, they're pretty strong down there in Egypt. We're hungry. There's no food here. And look, you're a pretty handsome woman. You're a good-looking chick. And so just tell him you're my sister. And it's all going to be good, because I don't want to be killed and then take you from me because you're my wife, and they'll kill me so they can have you. So just tell them we're related, okay? So you know what happens.
No deal.
What happens is she's so pretty. Now check this out. She's so pretty that she catches Pharaoh's eye, and Pharaoh wants to have her as his wife. So he takes her to the palace, the king of Egypt, and he's about to consummate this, and things start to go wrong. He gets ill. There's bad things happening. God knows what's going on. You can't fool him. And so they go, whoa, wait a minute. What are you trying to do? And they kick him out of Egypt. And they go back up, and then keep going. Chapter 16. Look at this one. It's been several years. God has made this covenant promise. But guess what? There's no baby. So what do we do about this? Verse 23. On that very day, Abraham took his son Ishmael. Ishmael? Who's Ishmael? Who is this guy?
He's illegitimate.
He's not illegitimate. I mean, this is a concubine. I mean, this is, you can have more than one wife in the Old Testament, you know, if you dare.
If you're stupid enough,
right? So Hagar's in the tent. Sarah's going, you know, look, buddy, biological clock done busted. You know, I'm up in my 80s, so let's do something about this, because apparently your covenant partner's not capable. So here comes Ishmael. Ishmael's 13. 13 years go on before Ishmael's going to get kicked out of the tent when Isaac gets born. Here's another one for you. Genesis chapter 19. Sodom and Gomorrah get destroyed. What does Abraham do when Sodom and Gomorrah get destroyed? Because you got to remember he Jewed God down, 50 down to 5, right? And Lot and his family are the only ones that, you know, it's less than 5. And really it's 1 because, you know, his daughters have sex with him. They keep having kids. His wife turns into a pillar of salt. So there ain't no 5 people righteous in Sodom and Gomorrah. So they hightail it out. God destroys it. And what does Abram do? He leaves the land under which I tell you to go. And he heads over to the Philistines area, to Gerar, where there happens to be a king by the name of Abimelech. And Abraham goes, you know, honey, Carlene, you're a fine-looking woman. Even at the age of 90, you're one hot chick. Because Abimelech looks at her and goes, woo-hoo, buddy, let's get married. She's your sister? Yeah, she's my sister. Okay, I'd like to marry this 85 to 90-year-old woman. I know, right? I know. I'm hitting the vanity of all the ladies right now. Abimelech wants to marry him. Then Abimelech starts to get sick. It's chapter 2, the same stuff from chapter 12, right? Same stuff. And so he kicks him out. But Abraham stays in Philistines country for a long time. Now, did God send him to Philistine country? No. Did God send him to Egypt? No. Did God tell him to say that she's your sister in Egypt? No. Did God say that him to tell that to Abimelech? No. So when we get to chapter 21 of Genesis, it's always bothered me, Glenn. Why in the world would such a cold, calculating, mean God tell him to take the only son he's got up on a mountain for a 3-day journey and stick a knife in him and kill him? What kind of God does that? Well, the same God who's been tested by Abraham for the last 15, 20 years. Abraham hadn't been much of a covenant partner. And so when we get to chapter 21, that starts to make sense when you think of covenant. We're in a partnership. And Abram continued to be unfaithful to his covenant partner. And he is testing God by saying, I don't trust you. You say you're almighty, but there's a famine. I'm going to Egypt. You say you're almighty, but I'm scared. She's my sister. You say you're almighty again and again and again. So God finally says, well, I'm going to test you. That only makes sense in covenant. Now, Hebrews tells us that Abraham believed that God would raise his son from the dead, Isaac. We get more information further down the road. But in covenant, there is a cutting, there's a binding, it's a walk into death, it's a covenant in blood, it is sovereignly administered by God, and it is unbreakable. And it's definitely an exchange. Now, here's the cool thing, guys. You and I are in covenant. We know that. Jesus tells us in those upper room moments in 3 of the gospel writers, John doesn't care about that. He's on another mission. So he doesn't talk to you at all about communion and Lord's Supper in the upper room. But Matthew, Mark, and Luke do. And when Jesus is saying that this is my covenant, we are in covenant, there's a seriousness. It's being cut in blood. Christ goes to the cross. It is a walk into death. It is sovereignly administered. It's an exchange of what I have and who I am for what you have and who you are. Isn't that cool? So when we get to the sermon later today, we're going to have what we call a covenant ceremony. We're going to walk through the covenant ritual. They did this for thousands of years. As a matter of fact, there's a lot of writing about it from guys like Robertson and Frumbull and other guys over time that recognized that not only was this happening with God in men, but it was happening between men and men. Because they didn't, you know, just write a piece of paper and we sign it like we do today. Matter of fact, in Exodus chapter 24, I think it's around verse 23, remember those 70 men that Moses put together so he wouldn't have to do everything? Jethro comes to him, his tongue's hanging out, he's just wasted, he's tired all the time. He says, why are you doing this? You got 2 million people, you can't do this. And so Moses, he says, appoint men to be judges, to do things. So there's what we call 70 elders of Israel. And in Exodus 24, the Bible records that these 70 men sat down with God and had a covenant meal together with God and did not die and saw him in his presence. Isn't that cool? You get these flashes from the upper story, time and time again, of God's covenant plan. For example, we're talking about Abraham right now, but how do you cut covenant with an entire nation? We go from Abraham to Isaac to Jacob. And every time God introduces himself, as a matter of fact, in Exodus chapter 4, at the burning bush, God introduces himself to Moses. He says, I am the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. Why does he say that? We get this thing again and again. Why would God say that to people all the time? He's reminding them of the covenant that they're in. So you have this activity in the upper story of God happening all the time. And every once in a while, we become aware of it. All right, so I'm out of time. Let's do one last thought. I want you to think on this, and we'll come back to it at the end of the lesson today in worship, but how does covenant change things? Because I got to tell you guys, when I started studying this in the last couple of decades, it changed my theology. Okay? And being born and raised here with you folks, I hope that gives me a little bit of grace and forgiveness when I say stupid things like I'm about to say. But growing up in the church, I didn't understand grace. What I understood was, it's kind of like Moses said, God says to Abraham, he says, I will. But to Moses, he says, thou shalt. To Abraham, he says, we're in a relationship. To Moses and the nation, through the law, he says, you will do these things. Because when you cut covenant with a nation, in order for each person in that nation to have a covenant relationship with God, they each have to sacrifice. See? And so that's where you get this sacrificial system for Leviticus. But on the other hand, to understand that God is using that nation to be a light unto the Gentiles, us, and show us his love for us, that nation has to not just be surface and superficial, which is what they became, keeping the law. Because they were about the law and keeping each point of it. And guys, growing up, I kind of got into that. I was going to make sure that I kept, you know. As a matter of fact, take this one for example. I love you, but there is no such animal as sins of omission in the Bible. Somebody taught us that theology a couple of three generations ago, and I learned it in my prayer. God, forgive us of sins of commission and omission, right? Omission means things you left out. So we're praying that God, please, if I die tonight, or for some reason I have a wreck right after church, and there's a sin that I don't realize that I did, and I didn't pray for, I'm going to hell because that one sin. What that tells me is that we did not practice or teach grace. Because we're worried about sins of omission. But if you're walking in the light as he is in the light, and his blood cleanses you daily and continually, then you're in fellowship, right? But see, we've been
sins of omission.
Well, it ain't in the Bible. But it's because we're scared. And my understanding of covenant changes that. I'm not scared if I have a covenant partner. 2 Timothy chapter 2, verses 11 through 13. I'm not going to read it now, but that's your assignment. 2 Timothy 2, 11 through 13. I would trade all of my theology for those three verses. Yeah, it's worth looking up now. All right, let's pray and we'll stop. Our Father in heaven, thank you so much for our time together and for giving us the ability to read your mind.